Hello everyone, I am David Jouancien, manager of the Genomic Facility in the Translational Research Department. Today, I will present you some results I obtained during my PhD concerning genomic structural variant, which lead to specific DNA scaffold and fusion RNAs in our aggressive uveal melanoma models. So uveal melanoma is a rare disease, less than 600 cases per year in France, and representing also less than 5% of all melanomas. This tumor occurring in the eye is mostly located in choroid layer, followed by the ciliary body and the iris. The primary tumor is a local disease and under the control of surgery and proton therapy. The main point concerns the metastasis occurring in around 50% of patients. Metastases are mostly located in the liver, followed by the lung, skin, etc. Main mutations are in the GNAQ11 genes. Those mutations are activating mutations, activating the GPCR pathways. And in this pathway, PLC-beta4 and CCLRT2 can be also mutated. A second event is present in most of uveal melanoma cases, in 80% in fact, BAP1, no, SF3B1 or EF1AX are mutated. This is a mutually exclusive mutation, in fact. And concerning genomic alteration, Nathalie Cassou, our surgeon, published in 2014, an updated classification of UM based on the genomic alteration and the structural abnormalities concerning chromosome 3, chromosome 6, and gain of the IQ. And depending on the loss of the chromosome 3, the gain of the 6P and IQ mostly, the outcome is different and the high risk is observed in the case where a monosomy 3 and a gain of the IQ is observed. Same result has been published by the TCGA effort. As you can see, BSC events and specific copy number alteration also propose a four class and four group classification. In order to improve our knowledge of uveal melanoma, and because of BAP1 mutation, for example, we've decided to dig into the epigenomic field, and we've decided to study the DNA organization in order to link this analysis to the gene expression. To achieve this goal, we've decided on specific models to achieve a specific whole genome sequencing analysis coupled to whole genome bisulfite sequencing to study the methylation, the DNA methylation. We also had the analysis of histone modification mark, the gene expression, and the DNA topology thanks to the in situ IC methods. Since 2010, since more than a decade, we study different ways to have models for uveal melanoma. And thanks to Fariba and Emati, we set up a lot of UM models grafting nor primary tumor or metastatic tumors. We've characterized different kind of models which recapitulate the different features of UM. And together with Fariba, we've selected two different models, aggressive models, in fact, MP41 and MP46. Those models have specific features concerning the status of the chromosome 3, the 6, etc. But still, they shared a gain of the IQ. They don't have the same chromosome 3 status. MP46 has a loss of the BAP1 protein expression. The two models have a mutation nor in GNAQ or in GNA11. And thanks to the lab of Professor Simon Saul in Curie-Orsay And thanks to Geraldinho, I was able to compare those models to normal choroidal melanocytes. And this was a very nice opportunity for our characterization. The first step of my PhD was to isolate the cells from fresh tissues. And to do that with the help of Ronan Crépin, with designed and validated nanobodies in order to sort tumor cells. Specifically, with specific nanobodies, we were able, in fact, to sort a lot of cells. Thanks to that, we've done the RNA-seq analysis, identifying more than 4,000 regulated genes. And this list of genes was compared to the specificities of the genome, its organization, the compartment, and so on. And recently, we've added to our analysis optical mapping and MFISH to confirm our results. So because the in situ IC experiment takes a lot of time, requires a lot of cells, and this is expensive experiment, we've decided to apply the specific pipeline, a bioinformatic pipeline, dedicated to the identification of structural variant and translocation. Nicolas Servant, our bioinformatician in Curie, applied this on our models and identified more than 1,000 translocations. Thanks to the whole genome sequencing dataset, this list was reduced to 50 translocations in MP41 and MP46. Those translocations were located in several places of the genome, but some were interesting for causing fusion RNAs and fusion proteins. So I tried to validate all the translocation using targeted PCR approaches, but unfortunately, I wasn't able to confirm any of the 50 translocations. And finally, thanks to the optical mapping, I wasn't able again to find those 50 translocations. So this analysis wasn't successful at the end. During the validation of the translocation, in fact, we did RNA-seq specific analysis. Thanks to Pierre Delagrange from GenoSplice, we applied five different algorithms for the fusion prediction. We keep at that time the fusion that were found in at least two algorithms and present in at least in two replicates per model. So among the 318 fusion RNAs, 14 fusion RNAs were kept and validated as present in our aggressive uveal melanoma models. And they were also associated with structural variants or due to specific DNA contact. So this is the summary of this analysis, but I will present you some examples of those fusion RNAs. So here is an example of MAPKINAS5 and AKAT10 fusion RNAs. This RNA was identified in MP41. MAPKINAS5 is located on 12q24, just after AKAT10. And as you can see here, after the seventh exon of MAPKINAS5, the fusion RNA is fused to exon 14, and this gray box corresponds to the sequence. I've done the PCR validation and the sequencing that prove that this fusion RNA is present in our sample. And this is the sequence of the fusion protein that could be produced. And going back to the DNA topology, we can see that in normal melanocyte, there is a subtad there. And surprisingly, in MP41, this subtad is modified. And thanks to the optical mapping, we saw that two alleles were present in MP41. The first one, this blue track, is normal and corresponds to the reference here in green. As you can see here, this pink box embracing AKAT10 to MAP kinase 5 is in fact duplicated on the second allele there, duplicated and inserted just after the seventh exon of MAP kinase 5. And this structural variant led to a specific fusion gene from MAP kinase 5 and AKAT10 and produce after probably a fusion RNA. So thanks to the optical mapping, we can see the coverage on each single allele, more than 60x can be seen on that picture. And in fact, this fusion RNA was previously detected by people working on autism, and Pierre Delagrange also identified this fusion RNA, into TCGA samples. So to summarize this structural variant, this insertion duplication in AKAT10 MAP kinase 5 modified the chromosome conformation, led to a specific fusion gene, and led to a fusion RNA in MP41. Here is an example of another fusion RNA that was identified between CABIN1 and MRPS21. CABIN1, in fact, is present on chromosome 22, and MRPS21 is present on chromosome 1. So first, I've confirmed this junction from exon 10 and exon 2 of the two genes. This was in agreement to the RNA-seq, and in fact, this fusion RNA could lead to a specific fusion protein again. Going back to the optical mapping, we can see that there is a contig here in light blue sharing a piece of the DNA from chromosome 1 and the other part here from chromosome 22. And more precisely, the breakpoint is in the middle of MRPS21 from chromosome 1 and in the middle of CABIN1 from chromosome 22. And thanks to the MFISH analysis, so here this is the multicolor painting, you can see an equilibrated translocation between chromosome 1 here and chromosome 22 in red. And as you can see, it's equilibrated. And furthermore, going back to the contact map, we can see specific contact in MP41 close to the breakpoint and concerning the localization of these two genes. And this fusion RNA has been identified also in three cases of uveal melanoma from the TCGA. And I would like to present you a first example of a structural variant that is a bit amazing for me. So we identified two fusion RNAs. The first one from GP84 and NCOS7. So going to this contact map, so here this is the chromosome 8, where GP84 is located. And this gene with NCOS7 on chromosome 6 give a fusion RNA, and here the letters underlined are corresponding to the junction of the fusion RNA. And there is in the same place, there is two other genes, POMK, also present on chromosome 8 here, with RSPO3 on chromosome 6. Together, they produce a fusion RNA. The sequence here corresponds to the junction. So this is validated after sequencing. And this fusion RNA can also lead to a fusion protein. So thanks to the optical mapping, we can see that there is a translocation between chromosome 6 and 8. The breakpoint is occurring from the chromosome 6 in the middle of temis and close to SFRP1 on chromosome 8. So as you can see here, this translocation is not so far from the four genes we spoke before. But taking a wire to try to have a model of what happens there, probably this new DNF fragment coming from the fusion of chromosome 6 and 8, so here is the breakpoint, probably the transcription starts from this era, from GIPT4, and the enzyme jumps to NCOS7 to produce a fusion transcript. And possibly the same occurs on POMK. The enzyme starts on POMK and finish on RSPO3. This could be an explanation of the fusion RNA. So this is not like read-through RNAs or transplicing. But because of this high number of contacts there, we think that this could lead to specific fusion RNAs. Nevertheless, going back to the contact map between chromosome 6 and chromosome 8, we went back to the MFISH and we saw that there is a complexity of the genome, like a chromotripsis, because when we look on chromosome 6 or on chromosome 8, and when we label specifically with for chromosome 6 or 8, in fact, here in the middle, we don't see that clearly here, but there is a thin layer coming from the chromosome 8. On this chromosome 8, there is this is corresponding to an isoderivative chromosome 8, with in the middle a piece of chromosome 6. And again, concerning the chromosome 1, we can see two dicentric chromosome 1 with a piece of chromosome 11 there. And next, a piece of chromosome 6, as you can see here, and a piece of chromosome 8. So this gives probably a specific genome instability. And this could explain the centric ring formation and the ring chromosome that we observed in our model. So probably we think that this translocation may produce different derivative chromosome 6 and 8 with additional modification and give specific abnormalities in ring chromosome. So to conclude, in fact, we've identified specific fusion RNAs with a non-function yet. Those fusion RNAs are coming from complex genomic abnormalities, which were observed thanks to the MFISH and the optical mapping. Concerning the next step, I will confirm the presence of this translocation in the primary tumor and in the early passages of MP41 using specific probes that targets the four genes of interest. And also, in order to dig into the functions of the regulated genes and on the fusion RNAs, we will do a specific data mining and text mining, thanks to the tool that Sébastien Tourlet designed previously. So thanks a lot for your attention. I would like also to take the opportunity to thank all my colleagues, especially my boss, Sergio Roman Romad, Fariban Emati, Josh and Elnaz, who make the integrative analysis, as Pierre Delagrange is doing right now on GIPSeq and so on. I would like also to thank my colleagues from the genomic team, Sébastien Tourlet and Radia, who did a lot for the MFISH. And I would like also to thank the different members of BioNano, who first helped me to perform the first analysis on BioNano in Clermont-Ferrand on the Janssen platform. So thanks to Michaela and Charles Poncet. But also thanks to BioNano, I was able to combine the whole genome sequencing and the optical mapping with the help of Yuval Prorat from Genox. So this collaboration was very helpful in order to improve the comprehensive analysis we were doing on uveal melanoma. Thank you very much.